Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to call the committee the whole meeting to order on this Monday, October 26th. I am Alderman Ron Singer. I represent the 4th Ward. I share that responsibility with my colleague, Alderman Jim Radecki. So let's begin now with the notice that all our council members are present today. So let's begin with the first order of the agenda, and that is to approve the committee of the whole minutes from October 12th, 2015.
So moved. Second.
Moved by Alderman Bruno, seconded by Alderman Marks. Are any questions on the issue? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. On to the items of business. Item 3A. We're recommending a draft ordinance amending Title 6, the Police Regulations, Chapter 2, Miscellaneous, Section 5, Weapons, adding subsection 6-2-5C, which is a regulation of air rifles. For clarification, and for the benefit of the members of the audience and those watching us this evening, this amendment to Title 6, Chapter 2, Section 5 of Geneva's Municipal Code is being recommended to provide a reasonable regulations on the lawful possession and discharge of air rifles within the city of Geneva. So I'd like to have Commander Nash address the issue, if we may. Commander?
I'll be playing the part of Chief Mexlin tonight. I just want to give you a brief summary of the changes that were made. I believe several city council meetings ago, there were some issues that were brought up, some concerns. The public brought up some concerns. He drafted an amendment that I believe addressed those concerns. Just going to do a brief summary right now. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer it. The gist of it is it will be lawful to possess an air rifle within one's residence or within the boundaries of another person's residence with the property owner's consent. For this portion of it, there are no restrictions on what the air rifle, the specs of the air rifle, have to be for possession, okay? It will be lawful to discharge an air rifle within the city limits only when it's done on private property with the consent of the owner. The BB pellet projectile that is shot, expelled, is less than 0.18 inch in diameter. Anything, for clarification, anything over 0.18 would be considered a firearm and therefore would need a FOID card. Okay, so we sort of addressed that situation. The maximum muzzle velocity of the air rifle used does not exceed 700 feet per second. The firing of the air rifle is done in a manner that does not endanger persons or property, common sense. The discharging of the air rifle is done in a manner that prevents its projectile from passing outside the boundary limits of the person's property. Again, common sense. It will also be lawful to discharge an air rifle within the city limits if, when the person possessing or discharging the air rifle is a duly enrolled member of a club, school, team, and the discharging of the air rifle is done in connection with the activities of that club, school, team. When used for this purpose, it shall be conducted on an indoor or outdoor range approved by the police department. And probably the question, I'll beat you guys to the punch, the question is probably going to be, what is going to be approved? It's common sense. What's going to stop that projectile from leaving that property? The only lawful manner in which a person can transport or carry an air rifle on a public street or public lands will be if the air rifle is unloaded and in a case, all right? I'll beat you guys to the punch. I know these questions you're going to ask. A case is basically going, there is no legal definition of case under the state statute. So basically a case is something that's going to conceal it, basically, and secure it. All right, common sense, a jewel bag is not a case, all right? This mainly is done to avoid those look-alike weapon-type situations, all right? The only lawful manner in which a person can transport or carry an air rifle in a motor vehicle in Geneva will be to do so when the air rifle is unloaded and is broken down in a non-functioning state or is kept in an enclosed case or is not immediately accessible. Which follows the state statute in reference to transporting a weapon. So that is the gist of it. It's pretty clear cut, pretty simple. It was designed, like I said before, all the things addressed issues that were brought up by the citizens, brought up by the city council. And again, it allows people to continue to be able to do what they wanted to do in reference to firing these airsoft rifles, air rifles, at the same time making the situation a little safer.
I would like to ask for a motion to approve.
So moved.
The agenda.
Second.
Moved by Alderman Marks, seconded by Alderman Bruno. We have discussion on the matter. Ms. Sino.
I just have a question. The paintball's diameter is larger than a BB gun or a pellet gun, so I just want to make sure kids are going to be able to.
Not if it's over 0.18. The 0.18 was basically the most common size BB. I believe that's why that was determined to be used.
So how are they going to do a paintball gun? Because the diameter is like not 0.18.
I don't have an answer for
I've
that one.
And I've never, I looked at a few of the airsoft guns, and I don't know how they would be broken down, so would just a case be okay?
The case. And that was, we had a really long discussion on that, and that really is to address the look-alike, and it really is about trying to get them to put it in a case.
Right.
Okay. Unfortunately, there some unfortunate situations can happen even right. When good kids make bad decisions.
The only issue I have is that the paintball diameter is larger than a BB. So.
Are there any other questions from the ice? Alderman Cummings.
Yeah, you know, I just looked up paintball diameter too, and it's 0.68 inches, and I agree that's probably got to be split out. I didn't look up state law on this, on definitions of air rifle versus paintball gun. But that is something that we talked about earlier, and that is something that I feel we had wanted to split out. And under this definition, it fails to meet it. It's 0.68 inches. Paintball gun shoots 68 caliber paintballs. Thin plastic shell filled with water-soluble vegetable-based dye.
I can only speculate that our focus when discussing this at the police department really did focus on the BB, the dangers of that. I don't know the previous conversations in reference to if it was brought up about that there was concern about the paintball aspect of it.
Alderman Simoneau.
Thank you. Couple things on. In section 2, sub II, we use the terminology, a person may discharge an air rifle within the real property boundaries of the person's personal residence. Shouldn't be personal property? I mean, it to me sounds like they can only discharge it inside their personal residence. When if you go up to the top under the definition of indoor and outdoor rifle range, it talks about is defined as an area fully within the confines of a person's real property.
I believe it would be real property.
So can we change personal residence to personal property or real property or whatever? Because to me, that just reads like you discharge it in a
like
residence.
You're shooting inside your house.
Right.
Yeah, you want to just do it as a friendly amendment, that's fine.
Yeah, I'd like
Alderman Mark, you're out of order.
That's one. How we handle it is above my pay grade. I agree with the paintball issue. I think it needs to be. And you made a comment, Commander Nash, that anything over 0.18 is considered a firearm,
and it would require a FOID. Any
so a paintball gun requires a FOID card. Is that what
it's if the projectile if it has the over 700 velocity and it's over that diameter?
It has to be both or either or?
It has to be both.
Okay, so if a paintball gun doesn't go 700 feet but it's a larger diameter?
Yes.
I would agree with Alderman Cummings and Alderman Sino that the paintball piece should be separated somehow. Do you know what the speed is of you know, the typical Daisy BB gun.
We actually did research, and no, not the Daisy BB gun, though I know what that is. But we did actually go to Gander Mountain and research the different types of weapons, the different types of air rifles that you could get, and there is a whole range of them. So I don't know what the average one is, but I do believe this is the minimum one. So
700 feet per second,
yeah,
is the minimum?
Slow compared to all the others.
Slow, okay. At Gander Mountain, when you had that range of all those, yes, BB guns, how many of them would have qualified for this versus?
I don't know that.
I mean, not a guesstimate.
I was not part of that research team.
Okay.
Alderman Simone, you completed?
Yes.
Alderman Radecki.
For the definition of real property, you know, it seems a little bit confusing, but that does by definition include land and residence. So I don't know if that helps you with the way it's currently drafted.
The definition of real property versus personal
is
residence?
Land and building. So
okay.
I think as it's drafted, the intent is what you, you know, what you think it is.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Cummings.
My immediate thought on the land versus property is somebody that has a residence in one place and owns land in another. So I would like to see that corrected. I understand that land at your residence means land, but if I live one place and I go shoot somewhere else, that is my personal property. I want to be able to know that I can do that.
May I talk? Real property would allow you. It's your property. So you would be able to shoot within that property.
Yeah, that's why I want to say real property in paragraph 2, sub whatever II, instead of person's personal residence. I want to say person's personal property. Person's real property. Because a residence is real property, but real property isn't a residence. You know, a little Venn diagram and all that. I did look up muzzle speed, muzzle velocity on BB guns, and 700 feet is rather generous. A lot of them are 400 to 560 feet per second. 700 feet a second will cause injury to skin. The BB can embed itself in the skin. That's a pretty fast. I think that that's probably a good over-under, so to speak, for muzzle velocity. And that's all. Thank you.
Alderman Maladra.
Yeah. I don't know. I think we're getting hung up on splitting hairs on terminology. The way I read Section 2, subparagraph 2, we're just trying to say your place or another person's place with their permission.
That's exactly what we're trying to say.
I don't see, you know, why it's so hard. That's the way in my thick-headed way I read it, and I think that it's pretty plain. The general direction of the ordinance is to a large extent what I was getting at the last time that I remember discussing it, trying to use velocity and caliber to separate out the Ralphie's gun from guns that can cause real personal harm and injury. However, I agree with Tom and Don and Mary about the paintballs. I didn't realize how big a paintball was until Don just mentioned it's 0.68. So we probably have to separate that out in some way, but in terms of the general direction of the ordinance, I think this is a big improvement over where we started.
Anyone on the dais yet has to express their views? Anyone in the audience care to address the issue? Sir, please come forward. I'd like you to state your name, your address.
Hi, my name's Mike Weissman. I live on 2N125 Virginia in unincorporated DuPage County. I'm a member of the Board of Directors of Illinois State Rifle Association. So I'm here on behalf of the gun owners of Illinois, and in particular, the gun owners of Geneva. So I'd like to thank you all for allowing public comment at this meeting. We haven't had a lot of issues lately to galvanize my people and to get them to stand up for their rights, and I think this is going to give us a wonderful opportunity. This bill seems to have been up for several different versions, and it's being sent back several times for more revisions, and each time it comes back, I see there's a whole bunch of questions. I don't know how many bites of the apple the city government is going to allow this bill to actually take. You got to wonder if it wasn't somebody's performance review objective in the police department to somehow introduce some kind of bad ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, I would ask that this speaker is out of order by criticizing the police chief who drafted this ordinance.
I'll take that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, and with respect to galvanizing, let's keep the conversation and your commentary to the facts of the ordinance. Let's not add hyperbole to a discussion.
I'm good at that.
Okay. Good luck. Thank you, Mr.
Yeah. Okay, so in the Illinois legislature, when they have a bad bill, what they keep doing is they keep doctoring it, bringing it back, doctoring it under the realm of never let a bad law die. Just keep trying to do whatever you can to pass something, because it would be a blow to someone's ego in order to back down from it. I see a lot of holes in this thing. I don't know how many more times you could take it back and put lipstick on it and fix it. I see real property versus rental. If I rented a property, does that mean I couldn't shoot my own BB gun on it? There's a lot of other kinds of things here, like the airsoft size versus paintball size versus pellet size. And if you look, there may not be any real reason to have an ordinance like this in the city of Geneva, because a lot of this is duplicitous with stuff that's already legislated by the state of Illinois in terms of transport of air rifles, in terms of air rifle size, in terms of shooting an air rifle on one's property. It looks like maybe the basic research for this bill might have been missed when they were drafting it. So I wish the city lots of luck in passing this. If it goes for the council for a vote, then I'll be back. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sir? We need your name, sir, your address.
My name is Kurt Koenig. The address is 2009 Allen Drive, Geneva, Illinois. I'd like to thank the mayor and the council for setting the bill aside the last session so that we might have a better opportunity to review the proposed ordinance, and we've been able to do so. I do understand that early on in the presentation of this bill by the chief, one of his major concerns was safety in terms of the officers that would be responding to calls for the identification or misidentification of whatever the person was handling at the time, and that he also mentioned that sometimes the orange top on a non-lethal weapon was removed, so they had difficulty identifying. None of that in the proposed ordinance has been addressed. In other words, we were talking about, he made a major emphasis that night, I believe we could review the record, on the safety of the officers. There's none of that here. I mean, it's just a question, but where is it? Because that was a major reason to put this forward. You also have a point of the limitations of the calibers, muzzle speeds. Those are arbitrary and ambiguous. The foot per second of a projectile coming out of a weapon is like somebody bragging about the fact that somebody has 400 horsepower in a car versus 500. But if it's got a lousy transmission and everything else, it's not going to go anywhere. A 177 pellet comes out, yes, very fast, but that's a special pellet put into there. Most of the speeds, which the manufacturers aren't going to propose because they want somebody to buy a bigger, faster gun, is going to be high, and yet within 25 to 50 feet of that coming out with that very light pellet, the pellet's kinetic energy is going to drop off, and it's going to be at 700 feet per second within that period alone. Yet, you also have a fact, you have a limitation of 177 versus a 22 pellet, and I hate to, I mean, have something come up that's in conflict, but right now all of you could go to Dick's Sporting Goods or Meijer and buy a 22 caliber air pellet, and you wouldn't need to have a FOID card at all. It's an air gun. All right? You wouldn't need one for that.
It's difficult for me to comprehend these figures that you're coming up with because I don't know the physics of all this. I'd have to ask someone who is somewhat of an expert in this area. So I don't know if there's someone here that could address that those issues at this point in time.
The two most popular pellet guns happen to be 177 and 22 caliber. A 22 caliber is actually used by the majority of people, let's say in the rural, or for using it for varmint or shooting purposes, because of the kinetic energy of the pellet itself will ensure that the varmint or what you're shooting at, in other words, will have a clean kill. It's also slower because I'm just talking about some of the energies involved. Basically, 1,100 feet per second is above the speed of sound. That's why you hear a crack when a air gun goes off. Below that, it's subsonic. The Olympic people shoot at 600 to 700 because the bullet's very stable and very accurate. That's the same reason with a 22 caliber. It's used for the same thing. But yet, you have something that's in conflict because you can't buy a 20, according to the proposed ordinance, you can't use that to be able to do what you want. In fact, the bullet's going slower, but yet because the bullet's larger, you're going to prevent that person from using that gun. Just like an airsoft shoots at about, what, as some of the research showed, it's going to be between 300 and 550 feet per second, but because it's a globular pellet, as stated in here, it's too large to be able to be in, you know, to be purchased by ordinary people. You also have a dueling conflict in definitions. In the definition itself, in the proposed ordinance, it says not a firearm, okay? And yet, when you're talking about the rest of it, you're considering the state definition of any weapon over 700 FPS as a firearm. Which is it? You have two definitions within the same ordinance. Which one are we going to use? And if I don't know, there's a whole lot of other people that don't know.
I can tell you I don't know. Alderman Radecki?
Well, I have a suggestion to clear that up, and that's just to make pellet guns the same as we consider all firearms and include them in with the firearms. You know, we originally tried to bring this back to make it more palatable and to liberalize what we were originally doing, and, you know, there's just continued criticism that we can't get this right, that we're not experts, so... You know, I probably wouldn't vote for this in its current form either because I agreed with the chief with the first thing that he proposed. So, you know, if we want to continue to send it back and add paintball guns and have a debate over the physics of the matter and continue to get into the weeds with it, we can continue to do that. But to your point, you know, I don't know that we'll ever get that. So, you know, my position would be to simplify it. Let's classify these as firearms and include them as we treat firearms within the city. Thank you.
With all due respect, as I started at the very first part, I thought the major proposal that this ordinance was being proposed was for the safety of the officers and safety of people. I have a suggestion for that. Air guns by nature and the airsoft guns have an orange tip on them. It's between a half inch and 1 inch long. That was proposed by the industry and well accepted. If the city really wants to move forward as a minor measure, but yet a safety measure for that, you can include all the air guns you want and everything else. Have proposed that they have to either paint fluorescent orange or tape fluorescent orange within 2 inches of the muzzle. It has to be visible. If it's not on that as an air gun, then put a violation and a penalty on that. You'll have an immediate identification. You're helping the safety of the officers. People can still use their air guns for training and for recreational shooting on their own property, as you suggested, which is well covered in the state statutes, and yet you've addressed the safety issue. And you don't have to mess around with the physics of a gun You don't have to worry about what can and can't be sold in a store.
Yes.
Is it Koenig or Koenig?
Koenig.
Koenig.
Thank you.
Does not the Illinois statute require that orange tip and or demarcation on the muzzle?
It was only on the airsoft guns. It is not required on the on your pellet guns, right, as at this point. So if you'd like to enhance the capability of the officer to identify a weapon, identify the fluorescent, have it put on the gun. You can buy the tape at Uline, and I'm sure, as a personal reference, George Havlicek could be carried in the store. I mean, it can be there. You can put the notice in. People can have it. It's a very inexpensive solution to enhance the safety of the officers and not put a burdensome ordinance that has to be, as you said, repeated over and over and over until it's winnowed down to what were we doing in the beginning.
But our law or our proposed ordinance reflects
elimination of weapons.
No. That was a dramatic statement that you put on your Facebook page and other sources.
I don't
that
have
clearly
a,
sent out to freedom-loving people. But anyways,
excuse me. I don't.
No. I've got the floor, sir. Let me ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Let me make a statement. Our ordinance reflects the state law, unless we choose locally to either enhance or amend that law for our purposes. So to argue, at least I believe, to argue that we should have certain demarcation, whatever, we do because it reflects the state law. All that we've recommended changing is some of the issues that we've discussed here locally.
Okay.
Now, we're not going away from state statute.
No.
Yeah.
But you're becoming with this more prohibitive than the state statute. And by and may I
because of the absentee of the pellet?
Well, in other words, you're reducing it to only one certain size. You've even eliminated airsoft guns, and there's other points. And I just would like to make a point, okay?
Sure, please do.
The Facebook page was with the Illinois Rifle Association, the Illinois State Rifle Association. Yes, my name was on that, okay, but what? That's not my website.
Tell your board member to correct it.
I notified them of the meeting. Okay, I am not a member. I simply made a call I'm not a member of the
Illinois State. It's the quintessential guilt by association. I apologize for lumping you into that unfortunate group.
Now, that was a comment that you asked.
No, board member's present. Your board member used your name.
I'm not a member.
No, your board member used your name to say, Mr. Koenig will represent us tonight.
Mayor, please. I just stated.
I'm stating the facts, sir. That's all.
No, the fact is I'm not a member of that association, and keep referring to me as a member.
No. I said your name was used in the communication distributed by the ISRA.
I am a citizen, yes.
Of course. Okay. Fair enough.
I'm simply stating that you have a very easy solution for this in trying to narrow this down to where you're reducing the opportunities for people as they currently have to a much smaller universe. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Commander Nash.
To address this solution, it doesn't address the solution. The as I said about the look-alike weapons, his solution, a very common thing for subjects to do that are not necessarily the best quality of people, is to actually put the orange tape on real weapons. All right, the law enforcement officer has to treat every weapon as if it's real. All right, I want to go home at night. All right, every weapon is real until we prove otherwise. Putting orange tape on the end of it doesn't solve the problem.
No, it doesn't.
Okay? So that's not a solution. All right, because again, it could be a real weapon, they could put real tape. Making them carry the pellet gun in a case, broken down, that helps the solution.
Alderman Cummings.
I want to back up what Commander Nash said earlier, that paintballs are included. The diameter of a paintball is included. It does put it into a different category. Also, despite what Mr. Koenig said, under 430 ILCS 65/1-1, we are not reducing anything. It is state of Illinois law that any pneumatic gun, spring gun, paintball gun, or BB gun which expels a single globular projectile not exceeding 0.18 inches in diameter, or which has a maximum muzzle velocity of less than 700 feet per second, on and on and on. We have taken it directly from the state of Illinois law. We aren't reducing anything from the state, despite what I understood you to say. I would like to be able to exclude paintballs, but I also am aware that without home rule, maybe we can't do that. I like the direction that this took from having zero availability of BB guns and air guns in Geneva to being able to own and use BB guns and air guns in Geneva. I like that direction. I would argue that we haven't gone backwards. We haven't become more restrictive. We are less restrictive than we were when this initially came up. I think the sticky point right now is paintballs, but if it's state law, we probably can't do anything about that.
I believe that's the FOID Card Act section.
Also, Chief Mexen addressed the orange tape thing, orange tip, meeting number one, and said that I hadn't considered somebody taping a real weapon. That's evil.
If they put that much thought into being good people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the kids, he had said, will take the tape, the orange tip off. And so yes, it's nice to increase safety. Some people may feel that we're going to increase safety by doing something with orange tape or orange caps. I would argue that we're going to do something with safety by eliminating or reducing muzzle velocity, as is in the state of Illinois, and projectile diameter. I think that moves us towards being more safe without eliminating the ability for somebody to enjoy some firearm sport. Thank you.
Anyone else on the dais? Anyone in the audience? Yes, Alderman Fino.
Well, so we can't do anything about the paintballs? Is that...
You make a motion.
Can I make a motion that we allow them, or...?
Ms. McCutcheon?
Mr. Chairman, if you want staff to try to address the paintball size issue specifically, and the real property versus personal residence language, we can bring that back next Monday with those friendly amendments included for your consideration. We can do that.
Would that be an acceptable request? The council members would agree on that?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. So we're tabling this motion until...
No.
No, we're not
just
tabling
it.
Just moving
it'll,
forward.
It'll be on next Monday's next agenda with those changes.
Okay. Yeah. I'd like to have an agreement on that issue. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Nay.
Motion passes. We are now on the item B, a recommendation to recommend a draft resolution declaring the Water Division 2000 GMCK-2500 as surplus property. For clarification of that motion, what it is the water treatment plant has purchased a replacement for this G-102 in 2012. The replacement vehicle was kept as a spare plow truck, and due to its condition, staff needs the Geneva City Council to declare the 2000 GMCK-2500 as surplus so it can be sold. I'd like a motion for that, Beth.
So moved.
A motion made by Alderman Bruno, seconded by Alderman Kilberg. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Moving on down to item 3C, we're recommending a draft ordinance amending Title 4, Chapter 2, Liquor Control, amending a Class D7 Geneva Park District liquor license. For clarification, the Geneva Park District has requested an amendment to their liquor license classification to allow for sale and service of alcohol at Playhouse 38, located at 524 West State Street. This amendment will allow the service slash sale at a leased premise and incorporates a yearly license fee. I think a motion to approve the amendment.
So moved.
A motion made by Alderman Maladra, seconded. Seconded by Alderman Sino. Any question on the issue? Anyone in the audience like to address the issue? I'd like to call for a vote on the issue. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? All right, we are now down to the issue of new business, and we have in the audience our Public Works Director, who is going to bring an issue forward. Mr. Rick Popka, sir, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the City Council, last Monday, we received some questions by one of the elected officials regarding the facility plan update that was completed recently for the wastewater treatment plant to comply with an unfunded IEPA mandate, specifically dealing with phosphorus removal. These questions came in rather late in the day, and we did not have time to distribute them to the rest of the City Council. I've actually reproduced these questions before you tonight, and we've also brought in our consultant, Amru from CDM Smith, who can answer these questions. We're going to try to keep it general but scientific. We don't want to bury the City Council in details, but we did want to take this opportunity to address those questions to the City Council as a whole. Just a little deep background, the facility plan update was completed earlier this summer and has been utilized as the basis for coming up with the design contract that was recently approved by the City Council last Monday. So that all being said, I'd like to bring Amru up.
Now, it's our understanding that this gentleman is going to answer these questions.
That is correct. Good evening, everyone. And any other questions you may have. That's correct.
Very good. Thank you, sir. Would you please address the council as telling us who you are and who you represent?
Amru Atassi, professional engineer in Chicago. I work for CDM Smith. We're a consulting firm. That's exactly what we do, water and wastewater. 5,000 employees nationwide. We focus in on water and wastewater treatment.
Okay. Well, thank you, sir. Begin.
Yes. So these questions were related to our facility plan and report, and the first one dealt with any microorganisms that are in the with the anaerobic digesters. There are two streams at a wastewater treatment plant. There is the liquid stream, as the liquid is coming into the wastewater treatment plant. The solids are separated, and they go into a solids treatment process, and part of that involves anaerobic digesters. The liquid from those digesters comes back to the head of the plant. That's what we call supernatant. So this is a very good question. It's a question that was addressed in our facility plan report, is what happens as we recycle that liquid back to the head of the plant. And it is correct, it does contain phosphorus that has to be dealt with. So there's two ways of dealing with that. Either you have a little treatment system for that liquid that's recycled to the head of the plant. And the second part of the question says, did we consider treatment for that, a separate treatment system for the recycled stream, or can we include that and factor it into the treatment process? One of the first things that we did to address this treatment and to this biological and this phosphorus removal is we developed a model mimicking the plant. And plant staff collected weeks and months of data so that our model, it's a BioWin, it's a nationally used software to handle nutrient removal in a wastewater treatment process, to model the nutrients as they're coming in through the treatment plant and all the organisms that are coming through the treatment plant. So we developed a model, and our model did consider the recycled stream coming off the anaerobic digester. So the answer to the first question is yes, it was considered in our analysis. We are not, we do not need to have a separate treatment system to handle that recycled waste. So that's the first question. Yes.
What do you do when you run into seasonality issues like with the microorganisms? My understanding is that at this time of the year, September and October, sometime.
Alderman Kilburg, would you put your mic on?
Oh, pardon me.
Thank you. How do you deal with it at certain times of the year when you your microorganisms, the activity level isn't at a desired level? Is that a correct assessment there that in September and October you can have challenging months
that
as
is,
it relates to this method of removing phosphorus can create a problem?
That is a very good question. So you're absolutely right. When we do the modeling of the biological activity throughout the year, and that's part of the reason when I said earlier that when we calibrated our model and we looked at it, we didn't just rely on summer data or winter data. There are different months of the year where, as the temperature is starting to drop, there are different activities within that biology. And so that was factored into the analysis. We did look at different water temperature, wastewater temperature as they're coming through the treatment plant. And we did calibrate against those events. But that is a very valid and good point. The second question is, which is related to the first question, is let's say there is something that happens in this biological activity. One of the things that could happen if you have a contamination or something gets into the wastewater treatment plant that could impact these microorganisms, you're essentially relying on microorganisms to eat these nutrients. And so if something happens to these microorganisms, that could affect the whole treatment process. So the question is, do we need a chemical feed system in addition to this biological system that we've added into this treatment process? Our analysis shows that the biological system will reliably provide that 1 mg/L, but anything could happen. And so one of the things we did look at in the study is a backup chemical feed system, essentially feeding a chemical to precipitate. Instead of letting the biology eat the phosphorus, you're adding a chemical that precipitates the phosphorus into the treatment process. That is an option. It is obviously at a cost. But one of the things we are going to do is we're going to see how this process works. And over the next couple of years, it could be added as a phase two. But at this point right now, based on a limit of one, I do not believe that the city needs to invest that capital cost at this point based on a limit of one. And the permit limit is relaxed. It's not requiring you to meet that limit on a daily basis. So even if you have an upset system and you do lose or something happens over a course of a day or 2 days, you still have plenty of time to get the system up and running because the permit is on a more monthly basis, monthly average versus a daily limit.
Monthly.
Yes.
If we need to get to a 0.5, are we going to be more dependent on adding a chemical feed system at some point in time?
That's a very good point. If the limit does change by the IEPA to a 0.5, a chemical feed system will probably be something you may want to look at because it's going to be difficult, especially in those days you mentioned, where there may be temperature or other issues that may impact the effectiveness of the process. It certainly gives the operators a more comfort level that there's a backup system. So if something happens with the biology, you can rely on a chemical feed system. But at this point, a limit of one, and you have time to make the system work, you don't need to invest into that chemical feed system at this point. It's just added maintenance. Plus, if you buy a chemical, you don't want to just let it sit there for months or years not being used. It's just going to degrade and lose its effectiveness over time.
Is it going to be more costly to integrate a chemical feed system at a later date, or would it be more cost effective to do it and essentially idle it until needed?
You could go. I mean, the cost efficiencies comes from you're doing a project right now, so buying the chemical feed tanks and the chemical metering pumps, there's economies of scale. But in terms of a process perspective and adding it later, there is no difference whether you do it now or later, but you bring a good point. There's economies of scale. You have a contractor. You can buy the systems in and then choose to buy the chemicals at a later time.
As we were working through this process with the staff, we started with a budget target range of about $7 million, And over time, it crept up gradually to over the $12 million mark. And when we started looking at it for scope management, to make sure that the scope hadn't crept up to unmanageable levels, this was one of the options we looked at. It is included within a potential phase two, which could either be 4 or 5 years down the road if the IEPA does drop the limits down to 0.05, or if we start having surcharge issues with, say we get, a meat packaging plant out in the industrial park that could generate a lot of biological discharge. That would be something we would want to retrofit the plant with. But it's come off of the need to have list. We wanted to keep the project addressing the immediate IEPA unfunded mandates and the absolute needed things that need to be done at that facility, because we are going into debt with this this loan. So it is on our horizon. It is something. It is on Dan's wish list down at the wastewater plant, but at this time, it's definitely within the phase two category.
The third question, is there a reason we're providing anoxic zone now? That's a very, very valid point. So again, one of the things we looked at in modeling the biological activity. Okay. So there within a treatment process, as the water, once you precipitate the solids through the primary clarifiers, it goes through activated sludge tanks. This is when you're trying to remove the biochemical oxygen demand and the nutrients. And typically in a conventional wastewater treatment plant, the only zone they have is an aerobic zone, which you have diffusers at the bottom of the tank. You're introducing the air as the bugs are eating these as the bugs are eating the food, which is the nutrients and these other things. They need oxygen to eat more, essentially. So one of the things we look at is an anaerobic and anoxic zone, which depends on how much you want to starve these bugs of oxygen. One of the advantages of adding anoxic zone is it can provide nitrogen removal, which is not currently in the MPDS permit limit. But it is something that the IEPA has discussed. In addition to having an ammonia nitrogen limit and a phosphorus limit, they're also talking about a nitrogen removal limit. This is not something that the city is required to embark on right away. We're not adding any new tanks. We're not building any new concrete. It's just a matter of the existing diffusers in the system, turning them on, turning them off, whether you want to introduce oxygen, whether you want to keep the oxygen away. But it is something we're thinking about, so that, 5 years or 10 years from now, when the city is hit with a nitrogen limit, they don't have to call on us, because the system is already in place and it's just a matter of turning off on and off the oxygen. The fourth question is again, it's related to that third question, is that we're not building new tanks, so we're taking part of those activated sludge tanks where the air is introduced, and we're converting them to tanks where the oxygen is not introduced. This is one way to achieve nitrification and phosphorus removal. So why do we need, is there enough aeration capacity left for BOD removal? The answer is yes, because the amount of air that's introduced in the tanks that are providing the air is going to be higher, which is also related to the next question, is if we do not need more air, then why are we replacing the blowers? And the answer is the blower capacity is driven by how much BOD, how much biochemical oxygen demand is coming through the system, and that doesn't change. The loading on the plant is not going to change. We're just forcing more air into these smaller tanks and using the other tanks to starve the bugs of oxygen for phosphorus removal. So I don't know if so it is a valid question. It looks like we're not adding more loading. Why are we introducing new blowers? Part of the reason also why we need no new blowers is the existing blowers that you currently have. You have five centrifugal blowers, 1,900 standard cubic feet per minute, is that the issue is not necessarily the airflow. It's the pressure to overcome the losses in the system. The static losses to lift that air into the aeration tanks. Those blowers also feed the grit tanks and the side stream system. So it's plus the aging nature of the blowers, you have an opportunity to go to more higher advanced technology blower that are more efficient, use less energy.
Most of the current blowers that are in use date back to 1975 or earlier. So there's also some energy efficiency by upgrading them to modern technology.
But the question is valid in terms of if the blowers met the current capacity, you would not need new blowers just for phosphorus removal. That's a very good point. But because we're taking care of everything at the plant, and without blowers, you cannot achieve wastewater treatment because you need that air for the bugs to continue eating the food that's coming in. Question number six is, should we be addressing the grit system? We are addressing the grit system as part of this project. There are two grit tanks. Each of them is about a capacity of six and a half MGD. And currently, the plant is running on one grit tank, which is why this project is needed. So as Rich mentioned, this project initially started out as a phosphorus removal. But then as we got into it, we found out that the blowers have static pressure issues and frictional losses issue to get the air to these tanks. We found out that the second grit tank is not operational. You're living on 6 MGD of grit capacity, and the plant sometimes can see it's rated for 12 MGD. So we are addressing that as part of this project by replacing, by repairing that second grit tank. Question number seven, does our scope include the solids handling study? Which again, we have the liquid stream, and then as the solids are removed, we have a solid stream. And yes, the solids handling study is included in our project. And the outcome of that study, whatever recommendation in terms of the solids handling improvement, is going to move into the second phase. However, if there are some things we can do via operational improvements or optimizations, we're not going to just walk away. We're going to say, here are some things you could do operationally without needing to build new tanks, without needing to build new systems. But if we do need to build new, you know, solids handling tanks or centrifuges or digesters, that is going to have to be in a second phase because that's not well defined right now. But the study and the evaluation of alternatives is included in item number seven. I believe there's one more question. Tertiary filters are usually kind of at the tail end of the plant. After you go through your primary clarifiers, your activated sludge tanks, then you have secondary clarifiers. Sometimes, depending on your suspended solids limit or your phosphorus limit, you might need to have, you know, solids that the only way to be treated is through filters. These are, natural filters where you have sand and gravel, and as the water is entering in, you're filtering out the water to take out any particulate solids. The limit right now is only 1 mg/L. We have done these type of filters in the East Coast when we've done these phosphorus removal projects. The limit is 0.1. Here you have a limit of 1. There the limit is 0.1 or 0.2. You cannot achieve a 0.1 or 0.2 limit just with the biological and even the chemical. Sometimes you have to put these type of filters or membranes. That's not needed right now. Is the IEPA, could they, 15, 20 years from now? It's very unlikely because it would be very, very costly for all utilities across the state. For example, if we were to add filters here at Geneva, that would be like a $5 to $8 million capital investment if that's required. So luckily, you don't have to worry about that. I think the plan we've got is going to achieve the 1 mg/L. You bring a good point about the chemical precipitation as a backup. If the staff in the phase two see that gives them a little more flexibility or they can sleep better at night, then that's something that could be added and it's not a significant cost.
There will be questions from the, Alderman Bruno.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If I recall going back to some of these early conversations, these phosphorus limits, this isn't an Illinois thing. This is all the states are addressing this. To the point of buying that that chemical injection system today, it seems like there's probably a pretty high demand for that as a commodity. I'm wondering if is it reasonable to think that once all the municipal demand has been met generally, that some of this will be cheaper in the future?
It's the same chemical that folks on the water side use. It's a chemical precipitation, alum or ferric. So, you guys use groundwater, you have a reverse osmosis system. You don't need that because you're groundwater. But any plant, any water system in Illinois that uses, whether it's Lake Michigan or the Fox or the Kankakee River, they use the same type of chemical. This chemical is alum salts or ferric salts, and you basically mix them with the water and the stuff precipitates. So I do not believe that. That's a big area for where
The physical infrastructure, though, is there going to be a higher demand to have these installed up front, and then
there'll be
excess manufacturing capacity?
Right. I mean, as more wastewater treatment, the biggest utility or the biggest wastewater plant that you're competing, if they decide to go there, is obviously the Chicago, the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District. So they just started disinfecting their sewage. You know, you guys have a UV system at your wastewater treatment plant. You know, some rules don't apply to Chicago. They just started, in fact, not all of the wastewater treatment plant goes through disinfection before it's discharged down to the Mississippi eventually. So if Chicago eventually decides to implement a phosphorus removal system and buy alum or ferric, that is going to drive the market here. And it is going to make it more expensive for you to buy this chemical or in any other utility, because they would buy so much of it because they're treating a billion gallons of sewage a day.
Thank you.
Questions? Anyone else? One of the concerns I have is that the product you're recommending is certainly one that certainly hopefully will be effective and efficient for coming years. And as the population of our community should begin to increase, are those factors taken into account? Presently, we have, 23,000 people in our community. If we begin moving towards 24,000, 25,000, I'm not sure that will happen, but one never knows, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years from now. Will this system be able to maintain that increase in our population?
We did include, and that's a very good point, and Rich made sure that, you know, we just don't think about what's what we have right now, but what's the capacity to be able to take on additional. We did factor in a small increase in industries and population. But in wastewater, the flows are just a small component. It's all the loading. So if you pick up another 500 homes, that residential load is not going to be a big deal. But if you pick up an industry that has a very highly concentrated, you know, raw sewage with very high nutrients or BOD, or, you know, then you know, so I'm just a little cautious to say, you know, you can, but we did factor in, you know, about a 10-15% increase, but it all going to depend on what that if it's residential growth, then it's probably not that big of a deal. But if you pick up an industry, that raw sewage, you know, it's going to be more challenging to treat at the wastewater treatment plant than you know, residential waste.
So that could be a red flag somewhere along the way.
Yes, we have to evaluate. The good news is a model's already been, you know, developed and calibrated. So adding those loads in is you know, you punch it into the computer and you get the results. Mm-hmm. So I think as those industries, as those loads come in, we have to look at them. And one of the things that could be looked at is kind of an industrial, treatment limit that puts limits on these industries is when they come in to say.
Could you give me a description of that type of industry that you're suggesting?
The industrial pretreatment program has been well in place within the city of Geneva. There are a number of industrial users that, for depending on what type of product they utilize, Johnson Controls is one, for example, where they actually have to pre-treat their wastewater stream before it's discharged. And in effect, what it's trying to do is stabilize their discharge so they're not shocking the wastewater plant and killing off the bugs and the microbes. Millard Refrigeration is another one. So they're fairly common throughout the, I don't say they're fairly common, there's probably less than 10 throughout the entire city. But some of the ones you might not think of are dentist offices.
Mm-hmm.
If they use a lot of silver in their fillings, in their dental work, and they actually have to be monitored. And there's a program that Dan Dobnik at the wastewater treatment plant completes on an annual basis, both with the permit review and then monthly sampling to ensure that they're complying with their pretreatment program. And then there's site visits also. I myself and Bob Van Gescom, the water superintendent, water wastewater superintendent, have been out to both Johnson Controls and to Miller Refrigeration to specifically to look at their wastewater pretreatment program.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? Anyone in the audience, sir?
To rest assured, if we did have a large industrial user, such as what Amaru just said, we would be looking at their wastewater discharge also as part of the building process and incorporating that wastewater permit and pretreatment program as part of their design process so they're not caught flat-footed. They would know what they're getting into.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay. Well, thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Is there any other new business to come before the council?
John? Mr. Chairman, I have one.
Yes, go ahead, Mr. Mayor.
I'd begin by acknowledging the fact that I think all of us have participated in recognizing and celebrating men, women, and children who have come before this council for their service, for their volunteerism, for their otherwise just good work to help make this community a better place. Tonight we get to celebrate yet again one of our own, Mary McKittrick. She doesn't know I'm doing this, so this is a surprise. In honor of 30 years of service to local government, Mary McKittrick is recognized for significant contributions and achievements in the advancement of local government administration. This is provided by the, ready for this, International City Managers Association, signed by James Bennett, the ICMA president, and Robert O'Neill, the ICMA executive director. This came when Mary was on vacation last week, so we snuck it out of her mailbox. Surprise her tonight. And that's for you. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Ms. McKittrick, would you have something to say to us?
Thank you.
Thank you. You're quite welcome. Anything else? Any other surprises for us today?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We are adjourned.
That was step one.